Now I request Dr. J.L. Sharma, who will speak on the origin and science of Mahamantra Om. He is eminent Indologist and educationist and former members of Rajasthan Sanskrit Academy, Hindi Advisory Committee, Government of India, Ministry of Finance, Exchange Faculty and Resource Person in Blue Coat School, Coventry, UK, and Minority Group Support Services for Hinduism. Dr. J.L. Sharma, please.
First of all, at this auspicious occasion of the first day of our Hindu calendar, the first day of Navaratra, I offer my greetings and felicitations to all of you present here. And in the context of the Mahamantra, I try to go, should I carry on in English or? Mahamantra, ultimately it comes to the science of sound. Whatever we are pronouncing, every sound comes out of a set of vibrations. It will be most inappropriate if we do not pay our gratitude to our ancestors, because it is they from whom came down any sort of knowledge or any science to us. I am reading two lines from Rig Veda. To pay our obeisance, our respect to them, that is etat vacho jaritar ma mimrastha jayate ghoshan anuttara yugani. The prayer is there that you, the seers — I am using the word seers here for Rishi — it is said, Rishayo Mantra Dashtaraha, to those whom the sound of mantras was revealed, they are Rishis. I am using the word revealed. Rishayo Mantra Dashtaraha. We don't say that such and such mantra was composed by that Rishi, but our tradition says that name, it was revealed unto us. And revelation is a sort of first-hand experience, and he only knows it, what is revelation and cognition, the difference between the two, who has practically experienced what revelation is. Something dawns upon the mind of a person, that is revelation. Gayatri Mantra said that it was revealed to Rishi Vishwamitra. Whatever mantra it is there, but every mantra is a revelation. More strange is the fact that here what he says to the Rishis, the generation which has passed, we are praying to him that whatever pledge has been taken by you, please don't break it. Jaritar ma mi mrishta. Let it not be a lie, but you have to carry on your words, you have to follow it. So that in the ages to come, all these things which are revealed to you and you told us, you made us reveal that, pass on from one age to the other. You must be all happy to note that perhaps that present age is going on. We have ushered into a new age now at this moment, because never before we experienced such a healing thing, such a joyful thing, such a thing whereby we could feel proud of ourselves. For the first time now only, internationally, yoga was acknowledged by UNO. Never before. Otherwise, what yoga was concerned? Thought long back. Even now, some persons may think that it is a physical exercise. Or if we take to the domain of spirituality, then it is concerned as something related to the sannyasis and sages only. But no, it is not like this. Even now, so many persons are mistaken by yoga. Yoga is not simply a physical exercise, but it is a science of mind. It is mind which is containing all the knowledge in it, and perhaps it has got the capacity to store in it what even a master computer cannot. उससे ज़्यादा ताकत हमारे दिमाग के अंदर है जितनी कि एक कंप्यूटर में होगी. Because who has made the computer? Computer has not made the man. Man has made the computer. And so try to understand what could be, would have been the power of our rishis, who could manifest so much of knowledge to us to the extent it was totality, the absolute knowledge. What is that absolute knowledge? Today, our tradition says this is biology, this is chemistry, this is physics, this is this, this is this. If at all there was any division of knowledge, there were two only according to our Upanishad, Paravidya and Aparavidya. Paravidya is that vidya, that branch of knowledge which is related to him, that is the absolute one, and the other is related to this phenomenal world, whatever other things are there. But do you think it is not possible that we can attain everything, every branch of knowledge? And therefore, Lord Krishna says in Gita, Jnanam Teham Sabhe Jnanam Pravekshyami Asheshatah Yad Jyatva Bhuyo Anyad Na Jyatavyam Avashishyate. Along with the science, I will tell you that Jnana, that knowledge, that after knowing it, nothing else remains to be known. उस संपूर्ण ज्ञान को जानने के बाद और कोई ज्ञान जानने के लिए शेष नहीं रहता है. उस संपूर्ण ज्ञान को मैं तुम्हें बताऊंगा, सभी ज्ञानम. ये वो ज्ञान है जो भगवान कृष्ण ने जो अर्जुन के सामने बताया. उसको आज पता नहीं कब से, सिंस टाइम लॉन्ग साइंटिस्ट हैव बीन ट्राइंग टू इट. And you know, science fails ultimately, because the limitations of science are to this phenomenal world only, not beyond that. One of my colleagues in physics told me, sir, we believe only in equations and experiments. I asked, if it is all equations and experiments only, then why the offshoot in physics, theoretical physics, has come into existence? Today, theoretical physics is an independent branch of physics. And the more it advances, the more does it come close to our ancient science. जितना ये लोग आगे बढ़ रहे हैं उतना हमारे ही तरफ जा रहे हैं. I kept on thinking. Luckily, on cosmology and cosmogony, a revolutionary book was published by Stephen Hawking. And when it came into the market, I was in England that time, in 1988, and immediately I purchased the first edition of that book, The Brief History of Time. It went on when I went through it. And then I published two papers from Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan, Mumbai. And Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan is as prestigious for Indological studies as is Oxford or Cambridge in English language. I said there only that I mention what is that absolute knowledge, because I'm telling a riddle which I mentioned and quoted from the book, a very interesting question, a puzzle you may say. Can God create such a heavy stone which he himself cannot lift? Can God make such a heavy stone which he himself cannot lift? Now whatever our knowledge says, if you say that he can do it, it means something is heavier than God. And if you say no, he cannot, then it means it is a negative point against our God, God's concept that he is not able to do it. Whereas we consider that he is omnipotent and he can do everything. I said this riddle may be accepted according to the Western philosophy, but not by us. Why? Because according to us, the knower and the known object are not two. Jnata aur gye, ye dono alag nahi hai, ek hi hai. It is also said in the Upanishads that after creating the world, he himself entered into it. So it is not far away from us, it is very much here. It is not the God which is sitting in seven skies above us. It is not the God whose slaves we are. And it is necessary for us to pray five times a day. That is not that God. So, in the light of Vedanta, I answered this question. Now going to the... It is a very, very spectacular fact. Persons are talking about language. But what is language in the modern world? Linguistics has also come into existence. But in linguistics, what do they study? They study the morphology of the language, the anatomy of the language, etymology and semantics. Morphology is the external structure, how the sentences are created, what the pronunciation of the word will be, that is all morphology. Second is morphology, and then comes syntax, that is the construction of the sentence, putting the words together to construct a sentence, and then semantics, that is the science of the meaning. But nowhere else the study was so comprehensive that the third aspect, how the sound is created, that is the vibration, was taken into consideration. Every verse cannot be termed as a mantra. हर एक मंत्र को मंत्र नहीं बोल सकते. किसी ने कोई कविता लिख दी, आप उसको मंत्र नहीं कह सकते. There are only a few mantras which are divided just like Vedic, Puranic or Tantric. And even the Shabar mantras are there. But what are they? A perfect combination of the vibrations of the sound, a word, when we pronounce it, its meaning, and also the set of vibration. All together, when assimilated and harmonized, they are mantra. And that is why, when the mantra is chanted, whatsoever mantra may be there, of course, I am here to talk about Mahamantra, that is Omkar. So mantras are that. I was reading a book about Mahamahopadhyaya Gopinath Kaviraj. He has been a very, very learned scholar of Tantra in the modern age, who lived in Banaras. So when he was initiated by his guru, he asked him to enter the Garbhagriha and chant Gayatri Mantra, and the lamp will light itself. Gopinath ji writes, I wanted to test it. I recited a few lines from the Tagore's Gitanjali prayers, some other lines, some other poetry in different languages, but to no effect. Ultimately, he says, when I chanted the Gayatri Mantra, as was ordered by me, by my guru, the lamp lighted. So this is the power of a mantra. And what is a mantra? It is a shabda. It has got a meaning and it has got a vibration. So that is the effect. I am coming to a very crude example to prove it. Person said, how it can be possible that vibration is so much effective? I said, you know, in the past persons used to say that he is such a wonderful tabla player, when he plays on tabla, the glasses of the house are broken. How is it possible? Is it possible because of the resonance created when the vibration of the tabla matches with the vibration of glass? Resonance is there, and that power of vibration breaks the glass. Those persons who are knowing a bit of sitar, there are two sets of sitar. One are over, which are touched, and the sound is created. Different pitches are created depending upon the length of the wire. But below the bridge, there is another set of wires which are not touched. They simply resonate. If the musician is playing sa, whatever the vibration is created below is set, another wire set on the same vibration, it starts resonating. And it is how the sound of sitar is magnified. Lipak, rag, etc., and all these things. Ultimately, music also originated from this sound. A concert was organized in Italy, when Mussolini used to be the dictator. Our musician Pandit Omkar Nath Thakur, you might have heard his name, he has been a very, very famous musician. And when they were discussing, Mussolini asked Panditji, I had not been able to sleep for days and days together. Do you have something that I may sleep? And Pandit Omkar Nath Thakur took the tanpura and started singing Rag Puriya. and the effect of Rag Puriya was that Mussoloni fell asleep. And next day he called the scholars of the Royal Academy to take down the notation of what Pandit Onkarnath Thakur has sung there. So all the things related to sound are such, you know, you cannot sing any rag any time for any purpose. They are also classified that this is the rag to be sung in the morning, in sandhya, or in afternoon, or in the night. In different moods they are sung. So this is also another creation of sound. It is coming there. But I am coming to another thing, that is, in Sanskrit only we had the philosophy of grammar. As I told you, today students are learning linguistics, different aspects of language. But what is the science of language? It is not known. Philosophy of language, it is not known to them. And therefore, the scientists of this, of language, that is the grammarians, came out with the theory of Isfot. What does Isfot literally means? It means an explosion. If we go back to the time of creation or before it, because the question is there, how the universe came into existence. There are different theories. But what is the most prominent theory these days? It is the theory of Big Bang. That there was a collision between matter and antimatter, and from that collision the universe came. And what is universe? Anything which is in the framework of time and space, that is the universe. So that is the theory of Big Bang. What was before that? Our Rishi, our seer, is very, very honest, and he admits. And in our tradition, Nasadiya Sukta of the Vedas is very, very important. They are the life source of our cosmology, our cosmogony. What was there before? Was it real? The unreal. Anything which could be perceptible, which could be comprehensible. But it says, nasid asin, no sad tadanim, nasid rajo, no vyomo paroyat, kima variya, kuhukasya sarmanambha, kimasid gehanam gabhiram. Samah, tada, tamah asit, tamasah guru magre apraketam sarilam sarvayo idam. Tada asit, tamasah guru agredam apraketam salilam sarvam idam asit. Everywhere the darkness was there. Neither there was real nor there was unreal. That is the sat and the asat. Now a question arises to our mind, that I thought about it. Why this contradictory statement has been given? That neither sat was there nor asat was there. The question is there. If anything is happening, we need an observer to see it. And when there was no second entity present at that time, we were not there, how could we say it was real or it was unreal? I think that is the honesty of the seer, that was the honesty of our Rishi, that he is declaring in very clear-cut terms that there was all darkness, if at all. Why? I remember a dialogue going on between Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam when he was in classroom with his teacher. A question was there, what is darkness? By the professor. And Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam answered, what is darkness? It is the absence of light. Since the light was not observable, it was not comprehensible, the general inference is there that it was darkness. And of course, in that dialogue, it is very enjoying. The professor who was teaching APJ Abdul Kalam, he said, do you believe in God? He said, yes. You believe that God is very merciful. But my brother was very, very religious. He every day used to go to the church and pray. But unfortunately, he died of cancer. Then how can you say that your God is merciful? Do you see him? After that, at this last question, Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam stood up and told, sir, you don't have your brain. The professor got irritated. How do you say that I'm a brainless creature? It is possible. I'm teaching you. And APJ Abdul Kalam says, okay, if you have brain, show it to us. Could he show? He could not show it. So, our dealing, it is mentioned that there was darkness alone. So, now in the cosmogonical theory, a term, dark energy, has also been mentioned. It is dark energy, which may be said as dormant energy. Because energy is such a thing which cannot be created. It can be transformed, but cannot be created. Because according to our philosophy also, anything which is created will ultimately be destroyed other day. But we believe in something, akshar, one which does not decay, that is the sound. So, again, that was the cosmological theory. Today we are talking about, mostly in the prayers, we pray to Omkar also, and it is Omkaram Bindu Sanyuktam Nityam Dhyayanti Yoginah Kamadam Mokshadam Chaiva Omkaray Namo Namah. We are lucky that on the first day we are hearing of this word of Navaratra, and the first day of our year we are hearing the word Omkar. But in this mantra also, in this, the word, the term Bindu Sanyuktam is very, very important. What is that Bindu? Because if Bindu is not there, we cannot pronounce the sound of Omkar. And that was the first sound which came out of the spot, that is the explosion, which was revealed to the Rishi. I am not saying that it was heard by Rishi. It was revealed to the Rishi. And what is Janbindu? There are two things. We say today the expansion of universe is going on. And how the expansion of universe is going on? Because in the galaxy, the rifts, which are having binding all the celestial bodies in the galaxy, they are rifts. Because of the decreasing gravitational force by the time, the distance among these celestial bodies increases in proportion to the distance. And therefore, the expansion of universe is taking us. It is in that, you might have seen some pictures, some diagrams also, moving that just like a spring, in a spiral way, not in a straight line. because our theory, everything is based on zero, which is not having a beginning, not having an end. Whereas the Western philosophy is based on linear motion, because if you are starting a line from the point A and ends at point B, question is there, what was before A? We don't have any answer. What will be before B? That is the ending point.
Sir, close, short karne.
Okay. We do not know. Anyhow, such a vast topic has been given to you, and I have been pondering my mind over different aspects of it. Om is not related to any particular sect, creed, or religion. It is a universal sound. It is universal because universal is that which is the object of experience by each and every way and everyone. Look at I read in Quran, three letters are repeated very, very often. Alif, Lam, and Mim. Some say there is no meaning. How at random these words appear? Alif, Lam, and Mim. What is the meaning? I was seeing a program. Then one Mali was saying, no, it has a meaning. But it is to be told and explained by other person. And those, therefore, you should go to a person who can tell you it. Otherwise, if you do not know it, you will be thrown to the fire of hell. We don't have any such theory of intimidation. In our religion, if it is not done, then you will face the fire of hell. Not like this. In English also, many times, Ameen, this word is used. No exact word. It is simply an expression of certain feelings. So it is Ameen. What is there? If you take into account the original sound of Om, it is the change or transformation into different religion. Muslims say Alif, Lam, Mim. And in Christians and other also, when they are very happy to accept anything, they use the word Ameen. So I have taken this word Omkar because when the ultimate power was dormant, one question I am asking, sound travels through a medium, but when there was no medium at all, how it could be realized and how it could be heard or revealed to the rishis? So that is that sound, which does not need any medium. And therefore, according to the theory, we are saying that there are four types of sounds: para, pashyanti, madhyama, and vakhiji. In Vakyapadiya and in Patanjali Yoga Sutra, these sounds have been mentioned. And ultimately, what Patanjali says in his Yoga Sutra, pranavah tasya vachakah. Pranav means omkar. Omkar is the vachak or denoter of that ultimate sound, which is om. And you know, it is because of the significance of omkar that if there is any mantra to be chanted, it is compulsory that pranav or omkar is used before it. I am drawing a very imaginary picture in front of you that if you are writing om, person say that according to our mythology, you know, if any puja is taking place, who is worshipped first? It is Lord Ganesha. And if you take like this, make the one theory is there that the shape of Ganesha was taken after the shape of Om. Bindu, of course, I'm not left with much time, but what I'm telling you, as the universe is expanding, universe will contract also. What is Shiv Tandav? Shiv Tandav, it is the destruction giving place to new creation. So that is a constant process, goes on and on. Nothing actually ends, nothing actually is destroyed, nothing is created. Lord Krishna says, na sato vidyato bhavaha, na bhavo vidyatah satah. Perhaps it is chapter number 3. What is real? Na sato vidyate bhava cannot be brought to the stage of non-existence. And na bhavo vidyatah satah, and anything which is really existing cannot be brought to the stage of non-existence. Now also, what modern science says, either matter is converting itself into energy, or energy can be manifested into matter. I am using the word manifestation, because according to Swami Vivekananda, manifestation and not creation is the key word of our philosophy. The whole world is the manifestation of that Lord. It is not a creation. So these important theories, long back when I was in 10th class, I read the theory of conservation of matter, that matter can neither be destroyed nor can it be created. It was must be in 8th or 9th class when I read it. Now the science has taken a step ahead, and it has, from matter it has come to energy. And so the equation of Einstein is not simply E is equal to mc square, but it says vice versa. Although so far there is no such experiment has been done as far as I know, whereby it has been shown and exemplified that from energy the matter has been created. But what we are today, we are the creation of that universe, living example. We are coming from that absolute energy, and we will be going back to that absolute energy. This is the cycle going on, and the cycle goes on with the sound of Omkar. The whole of the universe came out of that sound of Omkar. And again, when the contraction of the universe takes place, it merges into the sound of Omkar, and then it is Bindu Sayuktam. If you take its volume, it becomes just like a point. A point can never be measured according to geometry. It is measureless. And the source sounds, when the mass is contracted, it may be decreased to the size of a point, to the extent the tons and tons of mass you can hold in a teaspoon. I had lot to speak, because this is such a vast topic. Is Omkar is anadi and anant. What we talk about Omkar, that is also anadi anant. Hari anant, hari katha anant. Thank you.